Soulmate is connected.
Welcome. You enter 39943. There is one other participant in the conference. Please announce yourself.
Hello.
Muted. Unmuted.
Thank you. I want to be unmuted. Don't want to be muted. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Wiley Drake Show. We're live on the air with you. We just activated our, what we call the CCC. The CCC stands for Congressional Communications Channel. And that channel is open to you, and we would encourage you to give us a call. If there's a question you have, we are a television show being broadcast right now around the world on what most people call the World Wide Web. We happen to choose to call it the World Wide Wiley Web. And so you're welcome to join us. Some of you already have. And if you're on the phone line with us, go ahead and if you feel free, identify yourself and share with us. Would you please go ahead? All right. Folks, when I ask people to identify themselves, I always make it very clear that you're not obligated to do that. That's only your opportunity to do that if you would so desire. If you would like to remain anonymous, that's perfectly all right. We are a television show sponsored by the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. Now, that is not to be confused with another organization on the Hill called the Congressional Prayer Caucus. The Congressional Prayer Caucus is on the Hill. They've only been there a couple of years. We've been there as the Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. since the year 2000. Many of you go on prayer lines with other people that have prayer lines. You have people that are on there like Alan Parker, like Pierre Bynum and others. And they were all very instrumental in forming this prayer line that we have on now that is called Congressional Prayer Conference of Washington, D.C. And we do encourage you to call us during the show. Now, that number that I gave you, the call-in number, I'll give it again, and the access code, some people wonder if that will identify them. No, you're not identified on this program unless you identify yourself. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to talk about a lot of things today and give you an opportunity to talk about them as well. I have in the studio with me the gentleman to my right, and his name is Dr. Davis. Dr. Davis, tell us your title and what your function is here.
How can I be farther to the right than you are?
Oh, you meant where I was sitting. I'm sorry. Yeah. I misunderstood. I get confused. Ladies and gentlemen, I have the honor of working with Dr. Drake. I am primarily his director of security, but that gives me two duties. One, I have to keep him alive. Number two, I've got to keep the sanctuary as calm as possible. So it can be a little challenging, to say the least. The other is that I am the legal analyst and commentator for this show and for any other show that wishes to have the pleasure of my company. What I do is I take the legal issues that we see going day to day, I try to figure out how to put them into common sense terms and then try to explain them to our audience. And let me tell you, it is not an easy job.
Amen. And we thank him for that because we do need to keep on track. We do have some friends in Washington, D.C., the Family Research Council, and they happen to have a particular project called Call to Fall, C-A-L-L, the number 2, and F-A-L-L, calltofall.com is where you can find more information about it if you would so like to. Now, The call to fall is a prayer initiative, if you will, brought to us by the Family Research Council, led by Tony Perkins and their very able chaplain, Pierre Bynum. Now, these folks bring to us what they call the Family Research Council. You can go there and join them and be a part of them, whatever you'd like. But this call to fall is very, very important. By the way, we're going to be on July the 3rd, just the day before the 4th of July. We're going to be doing a call to fall weekend that is in churches all over the world, where people will come together and do what we do here at this church. Right now, we're broadcasting from the West Coast headquarters of the Congressional Prayer Conference. We have the privilege to office and meet here at the First Southern Baptist Church and Messianic Fellowship. And that's where we're at as we speak. Now, if you would like to be on this program live, you can come in and we'll scoot Mr. Davis over and give you a chair. If you cannot be boots on the ground, you can be prayer in the air. Join us, prayer in the air, 712-432-1690. And then it'll say, please welcome yourself and put in your access code. That code is 399-430-pound. And you can join us live on the air. Now, I notice from time to time the demeanor of Mr. Davis, Dr. Davis, changes. And I've noticed, in spite of the fact that he sometimes is discouraged, sometimes is in a bad mood, today it looks like he has something jovial on his mind. Tell us what and why.
Well, we're going to let our audience in on a couple little secrets. Secret number one is I'm not nearly as smart as I sound, but I do know how to use Google and Facebook. So fortunately for me, when Pastor Drake comes up with a question, if for some reason I don't know the answer, with my fleet little fingers, I'm able to hit the keyboard and find the answer for him. So that's kind of an important thing to do. The other thing is that I have been instructed by our producer, who unfortunately is not here today, she's helping a friend that has a doctor's appointment, that I'm supposed to be, quote, more entertaining, which I assume means I'm supposed to be more expressionistic, which is okay, fine, I'll do my darndest. So I hopefully am more entertaining than that. As I'm going through the Facebook and social media, I found an unbelievably great Facebook article. This is the world's most wanted terrorist, and it's a picture of President Obama dressed like a Muslim, and the title of it is Obama Bin Lion.
Hey, I like that.
I like that.
Obama Bin Lion. Well, Obama has been lying since all the way back in 2008. And let me give you a couple of websites that you might like to pull up for the audacity that we would have here, but also for the accuracy. If you would like to know the truth about Barry Satoru, a.k.a. Osama Bin Laden,
yes,
and
yes.
Barack Hussein Obama, you can go to the webpage, and it's a very easy one to get to. Just a few words. It's called Where's Obama's Birth Certificate? .com. Where's Obama's birth certificate.com? And you will see the proof of Osama bin Laden, and Bin Laden. You'll see the proof of it there. Just go to the website, Where's Obama's birth certificate, and you'll find it there. And by the way, if you'd like to know why I'm concerned about birth certificates and why I am sort of known as the father of the birther issue, you can go to your computer again and put in a SCOTUS. And tell us what SCOTUS stands for.
As is wont for the federal government, they like to abbreviate everything. I haven't figured out if that is to save typing space or because they want to sound smarter than we are. But anyway, it doesn't work either way. SCOTUS is the abbreviation for Supreme Court of the United States, the same way that POTUS is President of the United States.
Amen.
So they use these wazoo little abbreviations for that.
Well, thank you for that. And if you'd like to know more about the birther issue, not only go to wheresobamasbirthcertificate.com, but go to our SCOTUS, the Supreme Court of the United States case, and the title of that case is Drake v. Obama. Drake v. Obama. That's where Dr. Alan Keyes and Dr. Wiley Drake put together a case and took it all the way to the Supreme Court. And if you'd like to know why it is titled after me rather than Dr. Alan Keyes, get on the telephone, call me, and I'll explain that to you. As Ricky used to say to Lucy, Lucy, you got to explain it. So if you call me at 712-432-1690, put in your access code 399-430-pound, and when I answer, if you'll just say, explain it, Pastor, I'll explain to you why the case is titled Drake v. Obama.
On that subject, what I want to throw a little 2 cents worth in, because when I looked at it, I got offended. The way that they dodged the issue, the Supreme Court dodged the issue, is they said that Mr. Keynes and Pastor Drake did not have, quote, standing to raise the issue. That is absolutely, positively the most stupidest thing I've ever heard a court of law decide in my entire 30 years as an officer of the court. To say that an American citizen did not have standing to decide whether or not a person was qualified to be president of these United States, dumb in the extremis.
Well, and by the way, in case you're wondering, in reference to that, we are and were American citizens. Dr. Alan Keyes was previously appointed as the ambassador to the United Nations by none other than Ronald Reagan. And it was my privilege to have my degree signed by Ronald Reagan for communications, as well as it was my privilege to make 2 trips to Vietnam to fight for our nation. So if those kind of people don't have standing, we wonder who does.
Wasn't Ronald Reagan the gentleman who came up with the saying of trust but verify?
Absolutely.
Okay, I hate to change subjects, but every once in a while I see something that offends me, so I'm going to throw it out here and you all can join in being offended to me. We're already offended about the, we don't want to decide if Obama's illegal or not, bad, but I'm looking at an article on Facebook that says, the Muslim religious leader says that saying Merry Christmas is worse than murder. What? Excuse me?
Yeah. Well, as you know, people that are of a Muslim persuasion are indeed following a man who was illiterate, according to the records, according to his own writings. He was not only illiterate, but he was a child molester, according to his own confession, of ejaculating in a pre-teenage little girl and calling her his wife, and so forth and so on. But we'll get off that and move on. Now, this week, there have been some things going on that's been very important in the media. And FRC Action, I would encourage you to go to frcaction.org if you'd like to check it out. But it's called The Left's. We talked a little bit ago, Mr. Davis is on my right, but I'm on his left, but I'm certainly not a leftist. But the title of this is called The Left's Censorship. Well, the left's censorship is as easy as ABC. Now, I know that's a cliche, but censorship is as easy for them as ABC. The far left must be desperate for moral victories because now they're making them up. This past weekend, a liberal group launched a petition to ABC, ABC News. ABC, I used to hear, was called Already Been Chewed, and I believe that's the case. But anyway, among the many things that Tony Perkins from FRC said he observed firsthand about the intolerant left is they can't shout you down. They'll try to shut you down by silencing you. The reason is quite obvious. The facts, truth, reason, common sense are against them. What Mr. Davis brought up a little while ago, I try to put things in neat little categories. And when we have a victory here, I say another victory for Jesus and the good guys. We're going to talk about some of those today. But also, I have little sayings. And as he was talking about what the Muslims do and what some of these people do, I thought of one little saying, S-O-S. Now, you military guys know what S-O-S is, but I've adopted that S-O-S. And S-O-S is called Stuck on Stupid. The facts, the truth, reason, and common sense are against them, so they don't want a reasonable conversation. They don't even want a debate. They don't even want a debate. So, in typical stuck on stupid George Soros fashion, they tried unsuccessfully to pressure ABC to cancel Tony Perkins' appearance and then claim victory when ABC did so for completely SOS reasons. Mr. Perkins was a little more genteel. He said completely unrelated reasons. And they did that, and that was stuck on stupid. After leading FRC for a decade and a half, as well as working on the other side of the interview desk, which I've done as a reporter and now as a daily radio show host, and we wish we had Tony on the TV show. One thing is certain when it comes to the press, schedules change all the time. And I resemble that remark. We change the schedule all the time.
Excuse me, I thought ABC stood for the American Broadcast Company. Did something change when I was asleep?
Absolutely, it obviously has.
Oh, okay.
The media has to adapt to breaking stories of the day and different guest availability. When ABC canceled Tony Perkins' appearance Monday, it had nothing to do with this petition that an insignificant number of people signed. If that were the case, we could overwhelm their petition with one of our own, and we certainly could. This liberal, with a capital L, group previously claimed they banned me from other TV networks. But that was false. Again, SOS. Because I've continued, Mr. Perkins says, to make appearances on the network since Sunday. Just since Sunday, he said, I've appeared on the Fox News Business, twice on MSNBC, and twice on Fox News. Over the last few days, ABC News has heard from those who want to censor Christian viewpoints. Now it's time for ABC News to hear from you folks. It's time to speak up. When you turn your TV on, get a notepad and watch ABC. And as you're watching ABC and those ridiculous commercials come up, write down the name of the product that are advertising ABC and send them a letter or send them an email and let them know you're upset with them. Now, if you'd like to send an email, you can send it to abcnews.go.com/thisweek/mailform, etc., etc., and let them know where you stand. Go and tell ABC what your opinion is of Tony Perkins with the FRC and what your opinion is of them canceling his appearance on the show. Well, there was FRC action this week on other networks and even on ABC, but we're looking now at one from FRC, and the title of this is A Conversation About America's Future. And that's what we're talking about here tonight. We're going to talk about America's future. It's been called a reckoning, an inquisition, even called a quiz. That was yesterday's meeting between Donald Trump and hundreds of Christian leaders. Was a conversation, some said, an important one about America's future. The closed door gathering. Wiley Drake and the Wiley Drake Show was not invited. It was indeed a closed door meeting. Presumptive GOP's nominee had been the talk of the media for over a month. And yesterday, after weeks of planning, perhaps the largest assembly of social conservative leaders in a generation convened, hoping after 8 years of extreme hostile policies to build a bridge between them and the man who could be the nation's next commander-in-chief. I have one point to make about that, and that is, I don't care if it's Hillary, I don't care if it's Trump, the commander-in-chief is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ. Last night on Fox News, Megyn Kelly asked Tony Perkins why it was necessary for Christian leaders to start a dialogue with Donald Trump. Tony goes on and says, I'll tell you what I told her. I believe we have to be both an influence in this process and a witness to a standard of truth that is revealed in the Bible that we as evangelicals adhere to. When we have a candidate whose positions in the past were consistent with that standard, as in Ronald Reagan, we have to have a conversation. When we first discussed the idea, we thought 400 leaders might attend given such a short notice. However, the response was overwhelming. And by yesterday, 1,000 people in positions of influence from across the country gathered in New York City. The strong interest in the event only underscores the depth of concern that evangelicals have over the state of our union. We're going to talk more about that in a little bit. But as Tony said, he said, I said yesterday on Fox and MSNBC and later on the Kelly file, here's what he said. I think many social conservative voters want to support Donald Trump. They clearly know that the alternative is 4 more years of policies hostile to religious liberty and moral values. That is Thunder Thigh Hillary's description in a nutshell. But they aren't there yet. Greater reassurance is necessary for those of us who believe the Bible. For many of the leaders, Tony said, that he spoke with, the comfort level with Trump did increase as he responded emphatically to repeated questions about religious freedom. In fact, the only area that he offered specific policy prescriptions was on religious liberty and defending pastors' rights to speak freely from the pulpit. I will speak freely from the pulpit, whether the president likes it or not. In particular, Trump brought to the 1954 Johnson Amendment to the tax code. Right now, under the Johnson Amendment, church leaders are too concerned over losing their tax-exempt status. And I want to tell you something. I, as a pastor of a church that's a 501c3, they can take that 501c3 and put it you know where. I don't care. I'm going to preach the whole word of God. Trump promised that the leaders would be allowed. He paid special attention to the left's war on Christmas and even touched on Coach Joe Kennedy's inability to pray after a football game. I cannot believe a coach. Now, coach, folks, we all grew up respecting coaches. We all grew up knowing they were men. They were tough. Somebody tells them they can't pray. Well, I got news for you. The coaches I grew up with would say, to hell we can't. We're going to pray to heaven. From the Second Amendment to the horrible Iran nuclear agreement, the audience largely found themselves in agreement with Mr. Trump's message. There was some concern that Trump didn't completely address the question or whether or not he could reverse the Obama administration's social engineering in the military. Overall, there seemed to be a general consensus that he gets the crisis facing Americans' first freedom. Whether he understands evangelicals and social conservatives is a whole other matter. But one thing Trump and social conservatives do have in common is the shared experience of being a target of vicious and awful vile attacks from the left for refusing to surrender the terms on political correctness. It was Trump who said, the most important thing I can do is talk to you. Well, Mr. Trump, talk is cheap. Those of us across the conservative movement appreciate that he took the time to do so and hope the ongoing conversation results in concrete plan to protect the values we all hold dear. And we would encourage you to go to FRC's website to get more information.
Okay, can I put my 2 cents worth in on that point?
Well, you've got more than 2 cents worth if you'd like. Go right ahead.
One of the things that I was stunned about yesterday as I was surfing the web was the attacks on Michelle Bachmann and Jerry Falwell Jr. because they had agreed to serve on Trump's Evangelical Advisory Board. I understand if some people have some major issues about whether or not Trump is or is not a born-again Christian. I have heard very strong evidence that he is not, and hopefully before he dies he'll make the commitment. But regardless of what his personal feelings are, at least by having the consideration of creating an evangelical advisory board, he is certainly giving some deference to the very strong Christian power within the United States. When I tried to start figuring out, okay, why is everybody attacking Michelle Bachmann? Did she try to assassinate somebody? Did she try to burn down the White House? Is there something that I'm missing as to why she became public enemy number one? And so I started doing a little bit of research, and voila, the truth came out. She is anti-abortion, mm-hmm. and she is anti-married for same-sex couples. Well, oh my good heavens, I'm going to have to join her as public enemy number one and a half, because I too am anti-abortion, and I definitely am against gay, lesbian marriages. Now, before you start shooting at your television screen or computer screen, let me explain to you. I do not care if a lesbian or bisexual or transsexual or some other sexual couple wishes to have a, quote, domestic partnership. I don't care. None of my business. Privacy of your life, privacy of your bedroom, none of my business. What I do get upset about is the word marriage. Marriage is a holy connection between a man and a wife in holy matrimony.
Amen.
And it is not to be used for a bunch of sodomites or other people like that. So it's not the personal relationship between gays and lesbians. Do not care. It is a destruction of my Christian faith by telling me that what I grew up to believe a marriage was isn't really a marriage anymore. Yeah, I'm a little upset about that.
I'm writing something down here, and I'm saying the word sodomy is still S-I-N. Four words. Sodomy is still sin. You can rename it. You can dress it up. You can put a transvestite dress on it if you want to. But sodomy is still sin. And in case you're wondering what God's opinion of sodomy is, I challenge you to get the Route 66 book, that is the 66 books of the Bible, and go back there and read about Sodom and Gomorrah, and you'll find out what God believes about sodomy.
I just have a new definition for ISIS.
What's that?
Is sodomy in sin?
Is sodomy in sin?
ISIS.
ISIS.
That's not what ISIS means?
No. I'm sure they wouldn't like that.
I'm sorry, ladies and gentlemen. I get these flashes of brilliance, and I'm blinded by the light.
Well, unfortunately, he calls it brilliance, and I call it the shine from his head. But I'm always picking on that, but that's okay. That's why we love each other, because we can pick on one another and not go blow somebody up or cut their heads off or do something else. Well, ladies and gentlemen, sodomy is still sin. When a man lays down with a man, the Bible says that's an abomination. When a woman lays with a woman, same thing. When it says they do these things, it is an abomination before God, and it is sin, sin, sin. In fact, the Bible says sodomites will not go to heaven. Now, I know some of you don't want me to be anti-sodomite, but too bad. I'm not. God is. God is anti-sodomite. Well, with all of this discussion, with all of this conversation with Mr. Trump, I'm hearing people saying, oh, Pastor Wiley, you've got to vote for Donald Trump. If you don't vote for Donald Trump, that's a vote for Hillary. And if you vote for Hillary, that's terrible. Well, it would be terrible to vote for Hillary. It would be terrible if she got in. But, ladies and gentlemen, that's not the end of the world. If Hillary becomes the next president of the United States, that is not the end of the world. Oh, it may be tough, but I'll say something else. For those of you who are anti-Trump, if Trump becomes president, it's not the beginning of a new world. You see, whoever is in the White House, after the election, really doesn't matter, because God is still in charge. So there have been all kind of quotes made this week. There's been all kind of discussions this week. And I'm going to spend just a few minutes of our program right now with a response from an evangelical church leader in the United States of America. This response is from a well-known evangelical church leader. This evangelical church leader was not at the meeting in New York. Not because he was protesting, but because, in all honesty, he wasn't invited. There is another evangelical leader of the top rank in America, in New York, in Harlem, New York. And there is a man that is my pastor, Dr. James David Manning, the Honorable James David Manning, was not invited to that meeting of evangelical church leaders, nor was this evangelical church leader. You say, well, are you sure you're a leader? Well, in 2007, the organization called the Southern Baptist Convention, that's the largest convention, 15 million people strong, voted. They didn't appoint me. I didn't buy the position, but I was voted upon by the 15 million Southern Baptist organization called the Southern Baptist Convention as second vice president. So I was and am a leader in the evangelical church movement. But after serving my Lord and my Savior, Jesus Christ, for the past 50, after serving my Lord for the past 50 years and planning on another 50, but after serving my Lord for 50 years, from this day of June the 22nd, 2016 forward, I will continue to pray and issue my votes and my voting rights on the following document. On the Word of God, word for word, I will vote every day. And I will vote in the polling place, an only political party that can make a difference. The party is what he calls his saints, and I am one of them. Sometimes I don't act very saintly, but I'm a saint by birth. I received Jesus Christ as my Lord and my Savior, and that made me a saint. And that is the place the political party does its duty. And the political party is heaven. So, I will vote in the polling place and the only political party that makes a difference, heaven and his saints, of which I am one. This is my vote. Whoever gets elected, my vote comes from the Word of God. God tells me, hold not thy peace. For the mouth of the wicked and the mouth of the deceitful are open against us. I will vote because they compass us about with words of hatred and fought against us in Orlando and in San Bernardino without a cause. For our love, they are our adversaries. But David said, I and he and others should give ourselves to prayer. David went on to say, they have rewarded us, me and you, evil for good and hatred for our love. That man who went down there to that so-called love club, by the way, they told me that I've forgotten the name of the club now.
Pulse.
They called it a love club. Well, I didn't see love. I saw hate. I saw 49 bodies that were killed by a religion of love. And the Bible says, let Satan stand at his right hand. And I believe Satan was standing at their right hand. And let his prayer, my vote would say, become sin. That's what God said, not me, folks. And so, God said, my vote for Wiley and from God is this, 5 words. Let his days be few. Let his days be few. Let his days be few. And in case you think I'm being repetitive, let his days be few, and let another take his or her office. Let his children, folks, this is God's vote. Let his children be fatherless. And folks, those 5 words are my vote to cast. Let his children be fatherless. And another 5 words of vote, and his wife, a widow. Folks, that's God's vote. That's how God is telling me to vote. And we go on and on. In fact, in case you're wondering, that comes from the scripture, Psalms 109. And let there be none, God said, to extend mercy to them. Let it be unto him as a garment which covereth him. But do for me, O God the Lord, for my name's sake. I'm tossed up and down, the Bible says. Let our adversaries be covered with shame. That's my vote. Let them cover themselves. You want to see this in action? Watch the conventions. Let them cover themselves with their own confusion. GOP don't know what they're doing. Democratic Party don't know what they're doing. For he shall stand at the right hand of the poor to save him from those that condemn his soul. Ladies and gentlemen, you want to know how Wiley Drake's going to vote? Go to your Bible. Turn to Psalms 109 and read the verses. And you will see my vote. You will see my polling place is in heaven. And the only political party that makes a difference is his saints. Go to Psalm 109. 1 down through 31. I thought it was interesting. Some months have 30 days, some have 31. Psalm 109 has 31 votes. And I know people joke about Democrats. They say vote, be sure and vote several times. Well, I'm going to vote 31 times. Every day I'm going to vote the verses from Psalms 109, and I will vote, and we will see God still in charge, even if Hillary gets in, even if Trump gets in. God is not going to give up his world. You see, ladies and gentlemen, we were talking about birth certificates a while ago. Our birth certificate, as much as I love the Constitution, is not the Constitution. As much as I love the Bill of Rights, that's not our birth certificate. Our birth certificate is the Mayflower Compact. That compact, that contract, that commitment for America said, we're here, number one, for the glory of God, and number two, for the advancement of the Christian faith. And number three, for the establishment of a righteous body politic. My question to you folks, is the politics that Hillary has righteous? I know better. Is the politics of Donald Trump righteous? I know better. There's little difference between the two. So I will vote God's word, and I hope you'll do the same thing. Anyone like to make a comment or call in, please feel free. We've got about 14 minutes left. Dr. Davis, is there anything you'd like to share with us at this point?
It is important for us to absolutely, positively not give up our beliefs, our faith, our strength because of opposition by others. Do not, and let me say this very slowly because I don't want there to be any doubt to the strength of my conviction. Do not ever let anyone make you feel ashamed of your religion, Amen. Your Christianity, your belief in Jesus Christ as God, the fact that everything we have comes from God, not from politicians, not from the government, not from the liberal media.
That's right.
And what you do is you can take a suggestion that I would give. Way back in ancient history, back when I had hair, I used to debate literally the existence of God. So I would debate with atheists and agnostics as to whether or not God existed. And it
that's slightly interesting upon occasion. And so when you're allowed to do your summary of your debate position, my summary was very simple. I would smile and I would look at the atheist and I would say, you know what? If you are correct and there is no God, then I have spent my life being nice to people, trying to help those that I could help, trying to follow the moral path to throughout my life, and I am satisfied to know that I have been able to help those when I could help and not hurt those when I could have hurt them. However, if I'm correct and you're wrong, there's a special place in hell waiting for you.
Amen. Well, you know, the Bible makes it very clear when we talk about abortion, for example, that's a fancy word for it. Abortion is not the word. The word is, in the Bible, thou shalt not commit murder. Thou shalt not commit murder. And when you rip a baby apart and take the life out of it, you are committing a murder. And so do not commit murder, nor do you want to agree to murder. But I would say to you very clearly, we're here at this church to help you. We're here to show you the way. Many people will bring up the concept, the idea, well, here's a poor young girl. She just made a mistake. She got pregnant, and now she's saddled with a baby. Well, let me say to you, that's not a saddling. That's a God-created miracle. And if you are in a situation where you need help, come see us. We'll help you. We'll help you with medical care. We have a clinic right here in Orange County called Living Well Medical Clinic. We'll be glad to put you in touch with them. They'll give you a free pregnancy test. They'll give you free prenatal training. They'll give you free delivery. They'll give you all kinds of things if you're pregnant. So don't let the world that would say you can't afford to have a baby. Well, I've often said, if my wife and I, we had three girls and a son, if we'd have waited till we could have afforded them, we never would have had any kids. But the bottom line is, folks, God creates babies. I don't understand. But God does, and He knows what is best. And He wants you to have that child. If there's anything we can do to help you, please let us know. And by the way, over the years, I've had a great deal of opportunities to counsel. As I mentioned a little while ago, I've been an evangelical minister of the gospel for over 50 years. During that 50-year period, I have counseled with many ladies, especially ladies and some men, that have participated in the murder of their baby. That's got to be one of the most hideous, conscience-tearing situations. But I'm here to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, if you're a woman and you allowed them to murder your baby, you're guilty. If you're a man and you didn't do anything about it, or you suggested it, or you paid for it, you're guilty. However, God is a God of love. And God says to those of you who've committed murder, woman or man, abortion or otherwise, God says, I will and I can forgive you. Killing a baby is not an unpardonable sin. It is a hideous, hideous crime. But there are many other crimes that God forgives, and He will forgive you. If you would like to counsel with me as a pastor, you would like to counsel with me in reference to your murder of your baby, you and your husband, you and your spouse, you and your boyfriend, whatever it is, give me a call, 714-865-8132. That's my cell phone number, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Now, ladies and gentlemen, we only have 10 minutes left in this program, and then we're going to end. But before we do, If you would like to call in and ask us a question, we'd be more than happy to receive your question. Call us at 712-432-1690. Call us.
I'm going to real quick give you an offer. I'm probably slightly insane for doing this. But here's the offer I'm going to give. If you're a Christian and you find yourself being confronted by liberal media, by unbelievers, atheists, agnostics, Muslims, if you find it being opposed or challenged or attacked by anyone, please, pretty please, with sugar on it, give them the following number and have them call me and let me set them straight for you. You don't have to take on the argument. I will take on the argument. I'm a good advocate. It's what I do. So by all means, please give them the following number, 951-261-0799, and have them give me a call Monday to Friday, 8 to 5. After 5 o'clock, I like to try to wind down a little bit. But if they want to hear the truth from me, so you don't have to fight with them, give them that number, have them give me a call, and I will do my best to, quote, minister to them, and at the same time, give them a figurative bloody nose for being stupid.
Amen. Well, ladies and gentlemen, one of the things that we do here, we're Baptist by denomination, we're evangelical by practice, we're also messianic, and that's why you see a trumpet playing here on the desk. And I'm going to blow that trumpet in just a minute, because in life we see a lot of threes, and we see that in the beginning God blew the trumpet, and the trumpet was blown all down through history. And then we see at the end of history, one of these days in the future, God is going to blow that trumpet a third time, and that will be the time when we're going to heaven. So we're going to pray a prayer that the Family Research Council gives us, and then I'm going to blow the shofar to send us out into the battlefield to battle the devil and all of his demons. The prayer we pray goes like this, and would you follow me in prayer? I will answer God's call to fall on my face in humility and seek his face in repentance so that he might forgive my sin and heal our land. And now, ladies and gentlemen, as we're coming up on the last 5 minutes, I would like to blow the mighty shofar. In the Bible, it's called a trumpet, the trumpet of God, and the trumpet of the children of God, and the trumpet of his second coming. The Hebrew word for trumpet is shofar, and that's what this is, a shofar. I'm going to blow the shofar, and while I blow the shofar, I'm going to encourage you to send your prayers up to heaven. Shofar for our prayers. That is coming us, bringing us to the end of our program. Mr. Davis, do you have something you'd like to share?
Ladies and gentlemen, I have a confession to make. Everybody has a problem. Mine is a sense of humor. And unfortunately, it's even worse because I think that humor is pundamental. So if somebody wants to accuse me of being a pundit, I'm sorry, I'll accept that title. I'm looking on Facebook right now, and it shows a picture of Hillary, and it says that she has adopted a Muslim name to get more voters, and her Muslim name is Seldom Bin Laden.
Seldom Bin Laden. I have another name for Hillary. I call her Thunder Thighs. Hillary. Now, I know you ladies are going to get mad at me, but next time you see her on TV, check her out. You'll find out that she is Thunder Thighs. as you listen to her, you'll find out she's a vicious, vile sodomite. And so we have come to the end of our program now, and we're going to turn our phone line off. Anybody else on the phone line that would like to make a comment or ask a question?
One last thing real quick, if we don't have anybody that's on the other ones, come on. The Second Amendment is to protect us from government overreach. The Second Amendment, that means we can use weapons when the government starts violating our God-given rights. I ask any liberal politician that wishes to debate that with me to please come on, because I know there's a bunch of people pulling their hair out. I have no hair to pull out, but they may be pulling their hair out, saying, oh my God, he's threatening politicians with firearms. No, I'm threatening you with the Second Amendment and our constitutional rights. You get to defend your position about the Second Amendment of the and the constitutional rights. We're here Monday through Friday, 9 in the morning, 5 in the evening, Pacific Standard Time. Have a good day.